He's Rick. I'm an alcoholic.
Bob, alcoholic.
Okay, we're going to pick this up on page 68 at the bottom of the page, and we're going to look at this conduct inventory is actually what it is.
Okay, you ready? Now about sex.
Yep.
Many of us needed an overhauling there. But above all, we tried to be sensible on this question.
That'd be nice, wouldn't it? For once, let's be sensible on this question.
God gave us two heads, but only enough blood to run one of them.
I sure hope that made it to the tape. But I'm not going to repeat it.
But it's a good thought, ladies. Pay attention. It's so easy to get way off the track. Here we find human opinions running to extremes, absurd extremes, perhaps.
Yes, we do. And you will find human opinions running to extremes around this topic. And I think one of the reasons for that is that we're just very extreme anyway. And then when we got opinions about sex, it's really terrible. Guys, if you want to get confused, just go around and ask AA people what you should do about some relationship. You'll be so confused after about 20 different opinions, you'll have to kill yourself. It's insane. It really is. So we're going to look at the absurd opinions now. He's going to give us a couple examples.
One set of voices cry that sex is a lust of our lower nature, a base necessity of procreation.
Okay, you should just have sex to make babies, right? That's what one set of voices will cry.
Whatever.
Yeah, right. No.
Then we have the voices who cry for sex and more sex.
Yay, sex, right? Yeah. That'd be us, huh?
Who bewail the institution of marriage.
Oh, you don't need to be married.
Who think that most of the troubles of the race are traceable to sex causes.
That's the other extreme.
They think we do not have enough of it or that it isn't the right kind. They see its significance everywhere. One school would allow man no flavor for his fare, and the other would have us all on a straight pepper diet.
So those are the extremes, and you'll have who knows how many opinions in between those polarities. But it is interesting how well-meaning, I know all this is well-meaning, but we've got tremendous opinions. I don't know what it's like, again, what it's like here. But in Minneapolis, we got lots of people telling people what to do around this, okay? I don't know where it came from. I don't really care. I don't focus on that sort of thing. But we got a lot of people telling people, you know, AA says you got to stay out of relationships for a year. I mean, they actually will say it that way, attribute it to AA as if it's some kind of an AA idea.
You ever heard that?
It's all over. Yeah. Yeah. It's just unbelievable. Well, here's what AA actually says.
We want to stay out of this controversy.
Isn't that nice? Yeah.
We do not want to be the arbiter of anyone's sex conduct. We all have sex problems. We'd hardly be human if we didn't. What can we do about them?
Yeah, we don't want to be the arbiter of anyone's sex conduct, right? Arbiter, like in baseball, arbitration, the guy who determines what's fair on the contract, that sort of thing. I'll tell you what happened to me, and I had an experience early on in my sobriety, and I've been, you know, as dumb as anybody about these things over the years, but early on, I was trying to sponsor a guy when I shouldn't probably have been doing anything of the kind, but I was trying to, and I wasn't reading the book to him. We were just talking about problems, one of those deals, you know. And, of course, every time he comes around me, he's talking about some woman that he's in a relationship with. And it's constant. It's just a constant barrage of him telling me what she's doing and all. And this went on for a couple of months. And I got frustrated with him. I didn't know. You know, I hear I'm probably giving him advice and everything else, which I'm not particularly suited to give. I mean, after all, I ruined all my relationships. Why would you want me to help you with yours? You know, it just doesn't make any sense. But, you know, I was probably doing some of that. I don't recall. It's been a long time now. But one day I really got sick of it. And I said something particularly stupid. Something like, you know, 9 months sober, whatever. Something like I wouldn't sponsor him if he was in that relationship with her. Well, that was brilliant, huh? So here it is. I drive a stake between me and a guy I'm trying to help. I'm making him choose, in a sense, between what I represent as Alcoholics Anonymous and his relationship, if you call it that, whatever he was in. And guess which way he went? Never saw him again. Hopefully I didn't push him out of AA, but I may have, who knows? Maybe I pushed him away. Maybe I represented AA in a very negative way to him at that point, okay? That's the problem with doing that sort of thing, see? And I'll tell you, I learned a very good lesson that really changed me because of that particular circumstance. You know what I learned? I want to stay out of this controversy. I don't want to be the arbiter of anyone's sex conduct. Wouldn't it have been nice if I could have just read that in the first place and then applied it? Oh, no. I got to act like a fool. I got to do something stupid. Well, I never did it again. I can tell you that. That changed me, and I saw it. And so what would I do with a guy? You know, it says we all have sex problems. We'd hardly be human if we didn't. What can we do about them? I mean, at least that's the right question. What can we do about this stuff? Not whether one way is good and the other way is bad. None of that. Just what can we do about our sex problems? Well, we can write an inventory. And that's what this next paragraph is.
I used to hear AA says you got to stay out of relationships for a year. I always wondered what was the magic formula that happened on the 366th day.
All hell breaks loose.
I got a good friend who did that. He heard that advice, and he took that advice, and he stayed out of relationships for a year. And he said at the end of a year, he was a maniac. He was a complete maniac that was turned loose on the world because nothing had changed. He hadn't grown at all. He had just simply avoided looking at an issue that's very important in life that we should look at. Put it away. Didn't look at it. Then at the end of a year, oh, man, he's got 12 months worth of hormones all stored up, you know. Yeah.
You know what you call an alcoholic without a girlfriend? Homeless.
We say that about drummers, but it probably works better for alcoholics. Yeah. So, what can we do about them? Okay. We reviewed our own conduct over the years past.
So we're going to review our conduct.
Where had we been selfish, dishonest, or inconsiderate?
Okay, so on the sheet, that's what we put. We put exactly those questions. Where had we been selfish? And we put in our conduct, so you couldn't miss that this is a conduct inventory. Then we put, where had we been dishonest in our conduct, since that's what it asked, right? And where had we been inconsiderate in our conduct? So how might this look? Okay. Let's say you're married. You've been married for a long time. Maybe you never cheated on your wife or anything. But so how would I look at some of this? I'm sure others can give us better examples, but you might look at it as, was I using sex as a weapon? Maybe withholding it to punish when I was angry. Or maybe I'd use it, you know, to romance her so I could get something I wanted, you know, like a new truck, you know, or something. You know how it is, you know, manipulate and that sort of thing with that stuff. I mean, what have I been like in my conduct around relationships that were sexual? Where was I selfish? Maybe I was single and I was just screwing around with anybody. Didn't care if they were married, didn't even want to know, wouldn't even ask, wasn't interested. In fact, maybe even if I knew, I didn't care. I didn't care about third parties or anything like that. I just lied to get what I want, that sort of thing, you know. Maybe I was married and I was screwing around on my wife, that kind of thing, or in committed relationships. And so what's my conduct been like around relationships that were sexual? Where was I dishonest? Dishonest to get what I want, sort of thing, you know, lying. Oh, I love you so much. God, I just met her. You know, I just don't even know her, but I know she wants to hear that. And I know I can maneuver her into the bedroom if I say things like that, you know? Oh, I want a relationship. No, I don't. I just want sex. But I'm not up for, I'm not straight up about it, see? Because she might not do that if I was straight with her. That, you know what I'm talking about? That kind of stuff, you know? Where was I selfish? Boy, this is something that is a big deal, I think, with guys generally. I don't know about women so much because I don't know anything about women. but I do know what I've done, and some of it's not been so good. And it's caused me a lot of trouble and a lot of heartache over the years because of it. So those are some ideas, inconsiderate.
Yeah, I never cheated on, I remember.
I got to cue him up, see? You notice that? I got to cue him up for these stories.
See what I have to put up with? I mentioned last night that we both have exes named Pam, and they're different Pams. So when I talk about Pam now, it's my Pam. I never cheated on Pam. Never, ever cheated. We're sitting in a restaurant in Southern California down by the beach, and lots of attractive people walking by, and we're just sitting there having coffee in the morning, and I'm watching whoever's going by, just kind of, you know, doing the guy thing. And without even being conscious of the fact that I'm being very inconsiderate to Pam, who is a lovely lady, and I'm just doing this, and finally she says, you know, if you want it that bad, why don't you just go do one of them? Oh, man, she was so irritated. Like, I'm here with the woman I love, and I'm looking at everything else. And I didn't cheat. My motives were good, you know. Okay, I'm done.
I've been with guys, seriously, guys that I've sponsored, where I'm sitting at a restaurant, and they do so much of that, it makes me uncomfortable. Yeah. Have you ever been around that? I mean, it's just, it borders on, God only knows what you'd call it, but it's strange. Seriously. So, I mean, this is kind of a problem for men. And if a guy's unaware of this stuff like Bob was, it just affects your relationships and things like that. So we're going to look at some of this stuff. We're going to first look at our conduct. You can't start out with whom had we hurt, like some of the sheets that have been floating around, you know, that were set up like the resentment sheets. And they came from big book seminars, you know. And they start out with whom had you hurt. How would you know who you hurt unless you wrote an inventory about your conduct first? What are you going to do? Say, well, I hurt everybody I was sexual with? I mean, that's absurd. I mean, you might have disappointed them, but not... but hurt them? You know, I...
That's the same ego trip. I hurt everybody I ever had a relationship with. I didn't hurt anybody I ever had. That's two sides of the same ego trip, and neither of those is true. Probably neither of those is true.
So, I look at this stuff. So now I've got a basic idea of what my conduct has been like, where it's been selfish, where it's been dishonest, and where it's been inconsiderate. Then they ask the question in the right place.
Whom had we hurt?
Right. So now I can write down who I might have hurt by that conduct. So I've got some sense that... of what went on.
Did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness?
Now, I think it's interesting how they worded that. Did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? There are people who are jealous, suspicious, and bitter long before I came along. Okay? And you know that. You've run into that sort of thing. I have. But did I unjustifiably arouse it? See, that's a different question. In other words, was I playing games? Remember I told you I'd be out at the bar with Pam and guys would be around her and I didn't like it, you know, and that sort of thing. Then I'd hassle her on the way home and cause all kinds of trouble and heartache between us because of my insecurity. Now, I was not like this, but I've seen a lot of guys and I've known a lot of guys who did this. I'm not the kind of guy who just sabotages my relationships intentionally, okay? But I've done it unintentionally in many cases. But I've seen guys do this. Next time they're out somewhere, they're going to show her how it felt when she did it to them. So I intentionally go over to some woman and start schmoozing her right in front of her at a party just to teach her a lesson and show her what it felt like. Now, I got to tell you, the best way to have a relationship isn't to sabotage it at the same time. But what if a guy's doing that stuff and he really doesn't have much awareness of what's going on? Then he's ruining his relationships and he doesn't even know what's happening or why. But I got to tell you, so many people do this out of their insecurities. I'll teach her a lesson. So am I playing games? Did I unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? See, AA never says that you're guilty. They say, let's take an inventory and see if we've done something. But they don't automatically say because somebody's jealous, suspicious, and bitter that it's your fault. And I really respected AA when I started going through this and realizing what they were doing here. Let's look. Let's just look. It's not to judge ourselves. It's to find out what's going on.
Because they said unjustifiably, is that implying that there is a justifiable?
He's asking, because it says unjustifiable, does it imply that there is a justifiable? I was down in New Orleans not too long ago. I got that question from a lawyer. Do you understand why lawyers have trouble in the program? It's that big brain problem, you know. I did not know he was. You are a lawyer, huh? Yeah. There were like four of them in the meeting at this workshop I was doing, and that question came up exactly what he just asked, and the answer is no. Oh man, you guys are something.
You want to lift up the doormat and poke around the edges? I can certainly justify it in my mind. You know, I can certainly make it seem like it's justifiable. So, but I think probably not. Where were we at fault? What should we have done instead? We got this all down on paper and looked at it.
Yeah. Where were we at fault? We put those questions on here, and what should we have done instead? I think what should we have done instead is one of the best questions I ever asked myself. Because in hindsight, as I've gone from relationship to relationship throughout my life, as I've looked at them, I can see where I made mistakes. Now, when I was drinking, I would feel very guilty at the end of the examination, maybe the end of the year, I'd look at a lot of stuff and then I'd see all the mistakes I made, and then I wouldn't make any corrections. I'd just continue and do the same stupid stuff in the next relationship. See, that's the thing that caused me all kinds of problems. I can see almost every relationship has been the same for me. There isn't that much variation on this stuff. I did the same thing with this one and that one. I mean, it's just on. It's astonishing when you realize just how stupid I've been around these things. But I could see it in hindsight. I could see where I made mistakes. I just didn't correct anything. Well, I think the idea here is not to be judgmental toward yourself and hammer on yourself. It's to just get some awareness, find out what I've been doing, what worked, what didn't work. In hindsight, what should I have done instead is always a great question, because you can see it in hindsight. And maybe that's the whole idea. So, because the book is laid out where we're doing this, and it's going to explain why we're doing it in the next sentence.
In this way, we tried to shape a sane and sound ideal for our future sex life.
Yeah, that's why we're doing this. So I don't have the same problems happening over, unless you want the same crap happening in sobriety. I'll tell you, AA is a small town. If you do this stuff, if you're new and you start playing games with women around AA rooms, you will get a reputation that will be impossible to get rid of. And you think I'm kidding you. I know. I had this happen to me early on in my sobriety, and I still get fallout from this crap long after I changed and stopped doing it. It's a nightmare, guys, and it'll interfere in important relationships as you go along. And pretty soon you'll find some gal that you really care about and you want to be with, and she'll hear the gossip and the crap, and it'll cause all kinds of heartache in relationships that are important. It's really sad. I tell you, don't do this. Please listen to that. It will really be a problem.
Tell the story.
Oh, I'll tell you what happened to me.
This is And I say that because I actually was brought into having a part in this story, too.
Yeah. Yeah, this is interesting. Now, Minneapolis and St. Paul are across the river from each other, okay? My home group was in Minneapolis at this club. I met a gal in St. Paul. I was about 9 months sober when I met her, okay? And I was having, Pam and I had split up, you know, and we'd been apart now for about 6 months, and you start getting lonely and that kind of crap, so you're looking for something, and you know, you're like a walking gland, you know what I mean? You're just kind of looking for somewhere to go. And I'm standing at this, it was actually a dry bar, you know, they had dry bars back then up there, and I'm standing there, and I'm watching some people dancing. And this woman comes across the room, and she comes over to me, and she starts talking to me. And you could see she was interested, obviously, because of what was going on. And I wasn't particularly attracted to her, you know. I mean, but she wasn't bad looking, but she just wasn't. It didn't nothing really there for me, you know. I wasn't interested. But so we started talking. We had a lot in interests in common and that sort of thing, and we talked a little bit, and then we'd go out and have coffee and things like that. And I told her I didn't want a relationship. I'd come out of this relationship with Pam, and I just was not interested. I was absolutely 100% straight with her. Okay, and then we'd go out to meetings once in a while together. And I'm going to a club in St. Paul. This one club, and I'm going to meetings, and there are other women around. And I talk to other women, and she starts getting jealous, and that sort of thing. So this kind of crap went on a little bit, and then she's pushing at me. She wants me to sleep with her. She's pushing at me, and I'm not interested. Strangely enough, I'm serious about this. This is literally the way it went. And she's pushing and pushing and pushing. After a couple of months of this, I'm thinking, why the hell am I fighting this so much? I'm not dating anyone. What's the big deal? She knows where I stand, right? So I sleep with her. And guys think they can get away with that, see? Because we can do that, maybe, but you think women can do that, see? And it's different for a woman, if you haven't noticed, than it is for a guy. All right? All right. And the worst part is, I was straight with her about all this. I was upfront about it. She knew where I stood, but I wasn't going to be in any kind of a committed thing with her, and she understood that. So now I start going out with other women. Oh, she goes nuts. She starts pulling women aside at this club, and starts giving them an earful of trying to keep them away from me. Any woman who came near me in a meeting or whatever, pretty soon the gossip started all over the club. It was so, this is a big club. It was so uncomfortable that I left and just stayed in Minneapolis. She followed me over there. Yeah, yeah. About 5-6 years of this crap. You want to hear something even worse? Now it's going on over there a little bit. And she's coming around, and we start becoming friendly again. Oh, you'll love this. Guess what I did? You know what I did, because you guys did it too, didn't you? Yeah. Of course, slept with her again, see? And then started all that crap again. And it was going on anyway. I guess it... Unbelievable, man. And finally, I just said, no more. I couldn't. It was unbearable. These are all old timers at this club. She's gossiping to me about all these guys. She's slamming me to all these people that I started out with, you know, and this is 7 years in. She gets drunk. She got drunk doing that. She got back and stayed sober, but she got drunk over that stuff. I didn't. I came to a place in my mind, guys, and I'll tell you what happens. I don't know if you've had this experience. But I thought to myself, how do you deal with this thing? Now, everybody's got this perception out there of what I'm like now. And it's not even accurate, but it's there, you know. Some of it's accurate. It's sort of accurate, but not really, because I was straight with her and stuff, you know. Wow. What are you going to do then? Just gossip about her and start putting her down so that you can kind of offset all the crap? I can't do that. That's the dumbest thing I could have done. Well, I didn't do that. And I realized I had to get to a place. And this was important for me. And I got to tell you, this really helped me, by the way, where I didn't care what other people thought. I had to get to a place where other people's opinion was not going to be important. And it would just have to run its course, and in time it would change. And it did in time for the most part.
But you just got a feedback on this recently, didn't you?
I did.
What, 15 years ago, something like that?
Oh, this was, you mean what, that was 20-some years
yeah.
ago, you know? Yeah. And yeah, for a guy that I sponsored a few years ago was at a conference, and he was running some booth or something, and some woman came up to him and asked him who his sponsor was. And he told her it was me. I told him not to admit that I was sponsoring him. And he got an earful. And I mean, we're talking, and I had nothing to do with this woman. It was some perception of something else, you know, from somebody else. It was handed down. Who knows how that stuff gets handed, you know, how the story gets. Oh, yeah, it was just awful.
And we talked earlier about gossip in AA. This was early on. I had only just met Rick. We didn't really even know each other. I walk in the club. He was sitting volunteering at the front desk one night. And I walk in the club, I'm about three steps away from him, and three women come and they grab me and they haul me into the next room off to the side. And they give me this sermon about, see that guy at the front desk? He's evil, he mistreats women. They're giving me this whole routine. These are her friends, this is not her. These are people, women that she's indoctrinated to this. And they're doing that, with guys come in the club and they're pulling them aside and they're telling them all this controversy about Rick. Then later on, and she's not an evil woman. This is not, you know, I'm not going to attribute that to her. When she discovered, I don't know if I've ever even told you this, when she discovered that Rick and I were getting to be friendly, then she would get me aside. We'd sit in a coffee shop and have coffee, and she would be, well, tell Rick that this and tell Rick that. So
this was, I got to tell you guys, this is really bad. Yeah, I'm serious. This is really a bad scene, yeah. Man. And she did this all over the place. And I had these old-timer friends, and she sabotaged relationships with these guys with me. It was just terrible. And it doesn't go away overnight, man. It takes a long time for that stuff to clear. But you know what? I earned that. I hate to tell you that, but I set that up. That never could have happened had I not interacted with her at that level. See, I tried to use her for sex, didn't I? That's right. That's honest, okay? Now, does that justify what she did? Absolutely not. But you know what? It never could have happened had it not been what I did. Okay? Plain and simple. And you can justify what you do and say, oh, well, I told her. Hey, you know what? That's all crap, too. So you guys do as you please with that stuff. But I got to tell you, don't gripe when it happens to you. No sense griping about it because I put that out there. And what's even worse is when she follows me over there, I end up sleeping with her again like a darn fool.
Yeah, maybe you want to pass on the second time.
Maybe you want to leave the second time on. Yeah, I mean, really, this is just absurd. So I've had some great teachers come in and help me to straighten out. And it hasn't always been pleasant, but it's been very fruitful in the long run, okay? And it altered me. I some of this has been a real hard one with me. It really has. But I've had some great teachers. So her and I are friends now. She lives in Idaho, which is better. Yeah. Yeah, maybe you guys could find her. I don't know.
What's her name?
I'm not telling.
Nice potatoes.
Yeah. Okay. So that's a good experience. So that's like I told you earlier, I'm a good example of a bad example.
So to shape a sane and sound ideal for our future sex life, we subjected each relation to this test. Was it selfish or not?
You know, if I would have written this inventory before that and asked that question, is it selfish what I'm about to do? I would not have been able to do what I did. And I wouldn't have had that problem. But I didn't. And it went the way it went.
And you see this selfishness all over the place. You see, she's my wife. She's my girlfriend. She's my, you know, this is like a possession. And I own this. And I'm in charge of what you do because you're my wife, and oh boy.
We call that love.
Yeah, this gets crazy. We ask God to mold our ideals and help us to live up to them.
We asked God to mold our ideals, not our sponsor, right? Or our AA group, or, you know, what's acceptable to me may not be acceptable to somebody else. You got to take and write an inventory, and you got to be okay with it. It doesn't matter if I'm not okay with what you do. You're the one who's got to live with this stuff, not me. So I've come to realize that it's none of my business what somebody else's ideal is. That's their business. That's what they got to deal with. And I don't interfere in that. It's none of my business. Don't try and form some ideal. I'm so grateful that AA didn't do that. Say, you have to form the ideal that we set for you. And they're going to say that in a little bit here.
So we ask God to mold our ideals and help us to live up to them.
Yeah,
help
I need
us
help
to live up to them.
Because I don't want to live up to them. I want what I want.
We remembered always that our sex powers were God-given and therefore good, neither to be used lightly or selfishly, nor to be despised and loathed.
Yeah, so it's not about hating yourself over what you've done or the way you've acted. It's about making corrections and showing up differently. That's what I had to do. I started to do that. That's what's happened to me.
Whatever our ideal turns out to be, we must be willing to grow toward it.
Boy, isn't that beautiful, the way they say this? Whatever our ideal turns out to be, you determine that. But I must be willing to grow toward it.
We must be willing to make amends where we have done harm, provided that we do not bring about still more harm in so doing. In other words, we treat sex as we would any other problem. In meditation, we ask God what we should do about each specific matter. The right answer will come if we want it.
Yeah, so, you notice they slipped a warning in here. They slip a warning in here. We must be willing to make amends where we have done harm, provided we do not bring about still more harm in so doing. Provided that I don't cause more trouble. You know, why do they do that here? They don't do this in any other part of the inventory, but they slip a warning in here. And you know what I think it is? Because they saw, and I know that this is all written from their experience, they saw guys getting in trouble in this area. And maybe they start taking a little inventory. And here, I'll show you how I've seen it in guys I've sponsored. And in other people, too, that I haven't been sponsoring. They start feeling lonely. They're writing inventory. They see how they treated these ex-girlfriends. And, you know, they're lonely. They'd like to maybe hook up with something again, you know. So I think, well, you know, maybe I should go make amends to her. They're not going to make amends. They're going for something else, see. But they do this. I've seen guys do this. And there's the motive is absolutely crappy. And yet they go to do that and then get in trouble and cause more harm and more. And then they might drink over it. And then guys say, well, you just got to stay away from women. You know, women can hurt you and all. But, oh, my God, that is such nonsense. Why do we give women all this power? They don't have any power over me. What power does a woman have unless I give it to her? That gal had no power over me. I gave her that power by looking at parts of her. You know what I mean? Yeah. Yeah, explain, huh? Yeah. The lawyer wants an explanation. Yeah, of course he does.
And in fairness, they were pretty nice parts.
Yeah, yeah. But I gave that power to it. And then I suffered out of my allegiance to the power I gave her. Isn't that something? And then as dumb as I was, she comes around, I do it again. Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy. Talk about an idiot. Well, there it was. There was the stupidity.
When I busted up my relationship with Pam, I had a short term, about a 3-4 month rebound deal with a woman named Diane. And she moved out of town, and she was as mean to me as I ever was to Pam, so it turned out to be kind of a disaster. And so she left, and I'm thinking about it, and I'm getting to this stuff now, and I'm thinking about, well, I better make amends to Diane. I didn't know what I was doing, but I better make amends. So I wrote this amends letter. I sent it to her email. She sends me back. Her reply was, nice try. She saw through my BS even though I didn't. See, I was still clueless. I didn't have an idea what I was doing, but she saw through it. So I thought, well, I better fix this. Now I got to make an amend for making the amend. So I put together this long letter, and I sent her another. She sends me back, please don't make amends anymore. It's too painful.
I'll tell you, they saw this trouble. I'm sure guys were drinking over this stuff and that sort of thing. So they slipped this warning in here. You got to be careful with this stuff. This is really a touchy area. And it helps if you do have a sponsor that you can talk to or somebody you can talk to about this stuff. Because this is tough. But in other words, we treat sex as we would any other problem. So how do we treat problems? We treat problems in meditation, it says. In meditation, we ask God what we should do about each specific matter. It doesn't say you lay down hard and fast rules for every circumstance that comes along. It says it's fluid, see? Whatever the circumstance, you ask God about that particular circumstance. So it's not a lot of rules.
The whole program does that. This is all about ask God to help me grow. That's what the whole inventory process is about, that.
I don't think there's any part of the book that's more adamant about getting your reliance upon God than in this section. And why? Because they started off talking about how crazy people are about this topic. And you might have a sponsor who's crazy about this topic, you know? That's why it's important to go inward, form your own ideal. What's acceptable to me, not what's acceptable to him or somebody else. I'm the one who's got to live with it, not him. If you knew what my sponsor's views on this were, there's no way you'd do it. Maybe you would.
God alone can judge our sex situation. Counsel with persons is often desirable, but we let God be the final judge.
Why is that?
We realize that some people are as fanatical about sex as others are loose.
That's why.
We avoid hysterical thinking or advice.
Isn't that amazing? Here it says it again. You know, they just hammer this idea at home. God alone can judge our sex situation. So it doesn't say you don't talk to anybody. Counsel with persons, yeah, it's desirable. But we let God be the final judge.
Suppose we fall short of the chosen ideal and stumble. Does this mean we are going to get drunk? Some people tell us so, but this is only a half-truth. It depends on us and on our motives.
See, in that situation with me, she got drunk. I didn't. But my motives changed. I looked at what I was doing, and I realized what I was doing, and that was a big wake-up call for me. But I didn't get drunk over that. I made a mistake. I knew I didn't want to act that way anymore. I saw the damage that came from that for me and for her. No, it didn't help her either, you know.
If we are sorry for what we have done and have the honest desire to let God take us to better things, we believe we will be forgiven and will have learned our lesson. If we are not sorry and our conduct continues to harm others, we are quite sure to drink.
That's right.
We're not theorizing. These are facts out of our experience.
They saw it happening. They saw this happening. You know, I had a guy that I went through treatment with. And I'll tell you what happened with this guy. This is classic. Just classic stuff. We were part of an alumni at this treatment center, and we used to go up on the unit, and he was the president of the alumni, and we'd put on parties and picnics and Christmas parties for 200 people, you know, and we'd bring in speakers or a speaker, and it was a big deal. So the alumni was a real strong alumni. Well, he was the president, and I was the vice president, so I got to know Don pretty well, and Don and I were friends, and you know, I don't know how interested he was really in the program. He was a crack addict, you know, before he came in. So he was, whatever crack addicts do, you can all imagine, with women and things like that. So, but he was married, and he had a good wife. She was a decent woman. And I got to know his wife because I was going to Al-Anon, and I had a relationship with her separate from the relationship with him. We were friends, and I was talking to her about Al-Anon, and it was just, you know, because I knew they were trying to keep their marriage together. You know, I knew it would be helpful if she went to Al-Anon. And so she was. And we're talking about what's going on. And they had two kids. They had little kids, 1 and 2 years old, boy and a girl. Well, Don was screwing around with a woman at this treatment center. He's screwing around with this gal. And he says to me after a few months of this stuff, and I knew what he was doing, and I talked to him a little bit about it, but that's what he was doing. Here he's trying to keep his relationship with his wife, but he wants to do this stuff too. He's in major conflict as time goes on. He's getting more and more conflicted. He says to me one day, he says, you know, I can't stand to even go home. I hate to be around my wife. I feel so guilty. Well, of course. Look at what you're doing. Said, I told him that. I said, why don't you quit doing what you're doing if you're going to stay with your wife? Stop it. He wanted it both ways. He wanted to play on both sides of the fence, see? A couple weeks go by, you could just see he's coming apart at the seams over this one, you know? And he's about maybe 5 months sober when this is going on, 4 or 5 months sober. This is a decent guy. He's got a business as a real estate guy. He was an appraiser. I liked Don. I liked him a lot. About my age at the time, so we were in our 30s, and maybe he was a little younger than I was, but he was a successful business guy, too. Had a house, you know, had his family. And he says, I got to tell her. I said, Don, I don't think you should do this. Not at least right now, because their relationship was right on the edge. I mean, she was staying with him, but I'm telling you, it was tough. They were going through a lot of struggles. And I said, I wouldn't do that. I know your wife. And he knew that her and I were friends. And so I says, don't do that. He says, I can't stand it anymore. A few days go by. He goes and tells her. She left. She left him. She threw him out. He started drinking. The alcohol led him back to crack cocaine. 5 years later, I saw him. Now, I know what happened because I talked to her after that. She told me what she did and what happened. They got divorced. He lost his business. They lost the house. The children lost their dad. Can all that happen from one stupid choice? Yeah. One dumb decision and everything went. And nobody won anything on this. Everybody lost on this one. About 5 years ago, I was at a restaurant, and I ran into a guy who went through treatment with us. And I asked him if he knew anything about what happened to Don, because I saw him 5 years later, and I was trying to hook with him and get him to come into AA and come back, and I couldn't get him back. And he was practicing his business. He'd moved it and lost everything and trying to start it up again, and he was a mess. He didn't get back. He didn't get sober. So I asked this guy, have you seen or heard anything about him? He says, you know, as a matter of fact, I just read something in the paper about him. He had done something. Now, this was a pretty normal, average kind of drunk and dope fiend guy. You know, he wasn't mean. He wasn't really illegal or doing a lot of illegal stuff. He was pretty, you know, going to prison for some kind of illegal crap he got involved with drugs and with what. Oh, Jesus. So now he's in prison for a long time. Wow. Because he made a decision like that. So, you know, when they warn us about except when to do so would injure them or others, I mean, my God, he really believed that he could go back and tell his wife this stuff and relieve his guilt at the expense of hurting her. And he felt that he would feel better, and she would be hurt, but at least he would feel better. No, it doesn't work that way. He didn't feel better, he felt worse. It increased his guilt. It didn't resolve his guilt. So if you think you can just get well at doing something like that, you're wrong. It doesn't work that way. And I saw it so clearly. Boy, was that a great experience for me. It really woke me up when I saw that. And it's exactly what they've been laying out in the book here around this issue. They knew what they were talking about here when they wrote this. Yeah. Suppose we fall short of the chosen ideal and stumble? Yeah, it doesn't mean you're going to get drunk, but it will if you don't change. If we are not sorry and our conduct continues to harm others, we are quite sure to drink. We are not theorizing. These are facts out of our experience. That's exactly what happened to him. He wasn't sorry about what he did. He just wanted to get rid of the guilt at the expense of hurting her. Well, that was a nice situation at the end of that one. Well, that happens. And you see guys make those mistakes. And sometimes you can grab them and sometimes you can't. But it's the way it went with him. Maybe he could have talked to her at another time about that. But if he'd have quit doing what he was doing, he'd have had to deal with that stuff some other way, you know. But he didn't want to stop that either, see. Good lesson for me.
To sum up about sex, we earnestly pray for the right ideal, for guidance in each questionable situation, for sanity, and for the strength to do the right thing.
Yeah, we earnestly pray for the right ideal. We ask God. We ask God for the right ideal, for sanity, and for the strength to do the right thing. That's the thing. I need the strength to do the right thing. I know when I'm doing something I shouldn't do, but I just want it anyway. You know, I'm so, you know, I so many times I've acted on impulse, sexual impulse, that has caused me heartache. You know what I started doing a while back? And this is a long time ago now. But I was single, you know, and I'd be in a meeting and I'd see some gal or something that, and you felt the connection, you know what I'm talking about, you know, and it's just kind of exciting now, you know, because all this energy is pent up and you want to go have some fun and interact with her and you feel it, and you know what I've learned to do? Don't act on it. Here's what I started doing. I started stepping back. I'd get to know her. We'd be friends, but I wouldn't date her. I wouldn't go out with her and do that sort of thing. And I'd step back, and I'm serious, after about, if you can do this for 2 or 3 weeks, just step back from it and just observe it. You know what I've seen? I'm really glad I didn't get involved with her. You know what I'm saying? But I couldn't see it because I was blinded by my delusions, by my desires. That's not love. That's desire. And I'm telling you, love sees right through that crap eventually. You know, you usually find that out after you get married to her or something, you know. Just... But I'm serious. I stepped back, and not that there was something necessarily wrong with her, maybe not. But I knew that I didn't want to be involved with her. You know what I mean? It wasn't something I was interested in. But if I would have acted on that, then I'd have had more turmoil and more trouble because I'd have left her. And then she'd have gossiped and slammed me and all, you know, that kind of stuff. I've just noticed that I'm blind by my own desires. I don't see clearly when I'm looking through those eyes.
Sex is very troublesome, we throw ourselves the harder into helping others.
That's what I started doing. I started doing a lot of 12-step work with guys. You know how that goes? I could help her, right? Isn't that what you think? Yeah, I could. You know, she's pretty good looking. I could help her. How come I'm not helping him? Well, because I'm busy helping her. You know, I quit doing that, man.
I really have to add here, though, that it depends on my motives, because I have heard fifth steps and I have sponsored women and I've not had any trouble with that. If I'm not trying to get something out of it, if I'm trying to be helpful, it doesn't really matter if it's a man or a woman. It really doesn't.
Yeah, well, I haven't been very successful.
Women like you better. We think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves. It quiets the imperious urge when to yield would mean heartache.
Boy, I got an interesting story on this one. I was about 5 months sober. Pam and I had split up. She left at about 2.5 months sober. And we were living in a duplex. And I had free rent at this duplex. I had did some work on it before I went into treatment, and the guy was going to sell it to me. And when I came out, it was in foreclosure. So I had 6 months to live there after the sheriff's sale for free, you know. So I did. And she takes the kids, and a friend of mine owned the building next door, the duplex next door. She takes the kids and moves right next door to me. Now our relationship is over. We've been to counseling. We did everything we could. One of the counselors looked at us and says, I don't know if you're trying to stay together or get apart, you know. In fact, they even videoed, they did a movie of us as for some kind of demonstration purposes for other couples, I guess. I don't know. Maybe we were a good example of a bad example, one of those deals. So anyway, she's right next door to me now. Now my kids are 4 and 6 years old, two boys, okay. And she's right next door, she's living upstairs, and I just hate this. I wanted to keep my family together, guys. I really did not want to lose my family. But I can't do anything about this now. It's over. I can't change her, and I had to accept that. Now I'm going to Al-Anon, I'm going to AA, and I'm going to meetings every day because I'm in all kinds of conflict. I'm doing a lot of 12-step work because I can't stand it. She starts dating somebody. Now I'm living right next door to her. I see the guy coming and going, you know? Oh, it's killing me, guys. I got to tell you, it really was painful. And I'm scaring myself with my thoughts. You know what a guy does in a situation like this? He says things to himself like, well, I'll never have sex again. No woman will ever want me. Oh, Jesus, the self-pity, as Bill put it, oozing from every pore, you know? Oh, yeah. Some other guy will be reading my kids' stories at night. Oh, that's a nice thought. You know, that makes you feel real good. So I'm torturing myself with this crap, see? And I hate what's going on. I'm insecure. I'm insane. I'm doing insane things. You know, like going across the street to see if you can see in the windows, you get some binoculars and look and see if you can see the thing you don't want to see. Anyone ever done that? You try to see the thing you don't want to see. Isn't that amazing? Just to torture yourself, I guess. I don't know what that is. Drawn to the insanity. Well, this is troublesome for me, so I'm doing a lot of 12-step work. And I'm out there, man. I mean, I'm actively doing stuff because I hate how I feel. You know, 5 months sober, you're pretty raw. So I'm going to a lot of meetings, and I happen to be in a meeting on the north side of Minneapolis. I live south. And I like this group. We met on a Tuesday night, and in walks this gal, little blonde gal, gorgeous, absolutely a knockout, man. She comes walking into the meeting, and all the honesty went walking out. Everybody in that meeting was posturing at that point when she walked in. You could just see the crap. It was all over the meeting, you know. Everybody's, but oh yeah, it was really bizarre, you know. And I saw it. You could just see it. It was ridiculous. And I'm no better. I'm not, you know, I'm not any different in this sense. So I'm talking to her after the meeting, and she's kind of interested in me. And we're talking, we're getting along. And she says to me, "Where'd you used to hang around?" I said, "I used to hang around the Chug-a-Lug Bar on Lindale and Lake Street." The Chug-a-Lug Bar was a Grim Reaper bar. The guys, that was a bike club, these guys were prospecting to be Hell's Angels, and they were trying to prove how insane they were, okay? And here is the little blonde who was a prostitute who was dating the guy who owned the bar. And nobody understood what that was about because this guy was about as strange as you could get. Little, tiny, strange lunatic, okay? And she's dating him. But she was something, man. I'm telling you, everybody in that bar was just drooling over her back then. And here she is in the meeting. And she's talking to me. And she looks at me like, "What? The Chug-a-Lug, my boyfriend owned that, you know?" So that's when I realized who she was. So now we got this in common. So we're talking a little bit. We go, we leave. What? What do you mean? Huh? Huh? Yeah. So anyway, we go off and she goes home and I go home and we come back. She comes back to the meeting the next time. So we're talking a little bit. We get along after the meeting. We're talking and I think it might have been the next meeting. She came back again and we're doing the same thing after the meeting. We go for a walk. We're walking along. Now we got some things in common. We're having fun with each other and things look interesting. Now I got to tell you something. I'm afraid of women back then. I was 35 years old. And I was afraid of women because I felt all that pain around Pam that I literally was a scare. I was afraid. I was shaking. It was just bizarre. It was like I was 14 years old again. It was just strange. And I'm excited at this proposition, but I'm afraid of her to some degree. It's kind of weird. And we start talking again. She says, "Well, what's your deal?" Meaning relationship. And she's coming on to me big time through this, okay? I mean, she's pretty straightforward about what she wants. She's not pulling any punches. She says, "What's your deal?" Meaning relationship. I says, "Well, you know, Pam and I were together for 11 years, and we split up a few months ago, and she took the kids, and she's living right next door to me. I got two boys, 4 and 6 years old." She looks at me like I got two heads. She says, "You're kidding." I said, "No." She says, "I got two kids. My husband and I are separated, and he lives right next door to me." I swear to you, this is a true story. Now I'm interacting with Pam, in a sense. You following me? This is, yeah. So now... there's a guy living next door to his wife. He has kids, and he's in my position, see, with Pam. Wow. And she told me that they were separated. They weren't divorced, and they were still working on a relationship. I didn't really want that information. But she laid that out there real clearly, okay? And she told me that she was interested and she wanted to be sexual with me that night. And oh God, the conflict. You know what came to my mind? I swear to you, this is true. I'd been reading this part of the inventory. And here's what I heard. We subjected each relation to this test. Was it selfish or not? That's what I heard in my head. Now, I'm telling you, this is astonishing to me. Why that came into my mind at that particular time, but it did. And I thought to myself,
Rick.
Yeah. Do you want to be the guy to drive a stake between that man next door to his family and his kids? Do you want to drive a stake between that relationship that he has with his wife? Do you overenact the sex? Kind of. But no, I didn't. No, I didn't. I didn't think that way. That's a lie. Okay? I got to tell you, this was very difficult for me because I knew what I would do if I did that. I would actually cause a problem between that man living next door to his children. Now, I knew what it felt like when Pam was dating that guy. Okay? And I'd see him come and go. And in fact, I saw her kissing him one time out in front of the house. It was just killing me, guys, seriously. And here it is now. I'm in a situation where I could be that guy. And her relationship isn't over. See, Pam was doing nothing wrong. Our relationship was over. But that was not true in this situation. And I get, is it selfish or not what I'm going to do here? You bet it was. And I stepped back from it, and I told her, I says, you know, and I believe me, this wasn't easy. I had enough sensitivity, and I'm glad I did this. And so was she. I told her, I says, you know, it's not a problem from my side here, because she literally asked me to do this. It's not a problem from my side. My relationship is over, but you told me that you're still trying to keep your family together. And I said, I can't do that. And she thanked me for telling her why I couldn't do it. Instead of just rejecting her, I explained to her why I couldn't. And she agreed, and she thanked me for that. And I talked to her. That was a Tuesday night. I talked to her that Thursday, and that was the last conversation I had with her. She never came back to the meeting, and I never saw her again. So I don't know if they stayed together. I don't know what the outcome of that situation was. But I'm telling you, I'm glad I made the choice I made. Now, I want something to be really crystal clear here. I would love to sit here and tell you I was working a program and I was a good AA member and I did that all because of that. That's not true. It's not true. I'll tell you why I didn't act on that. It would have brought me into major conflict with myself. I would have hated myself if I felt that I destroyed some guy's family, if I broke up a family. There was nothing noble about what I did. It was pure self-interest. Now, it wasn't selfish, because selfish means without concern for others. But I'm not deluded into thinking that I was a good guy by doing that. I would have hated myself, and I don't know if I'd have used over it, but I certainly would have been miserable if I felt that I caused some kid to be raised in a family that was busted up because of something I did. I couldn't do it. So I'm very grateful that I did what I did there. But I got to tell you something, that's being a pretty ordinary guy. There's nothing too noble about that. Most normal people with any sort of morality would not act on that, okay? But unfortunately, that's not the way I grew up, and that's not the way I was when I got sober, and it's not the way I was in my early sobriety. So some of these things have been really hard won. What's really fascinating about that particular situation is about maybe 10 years later, 15 maybe years later, I'm at the mission putting on a meeting. And I'm telling this story in the group to these guys who are in the program there. There's a little guy off to the right whose eyes are getting huge as I'm telling this story. And all of a sudden he pipes up and he says, That was my girlfriend. Not her husband. The guy who owned the bar, Jack, was in the treatment center. Okay. Isn't that weird? Here he's in there. I'm telling the story. He looks at me. He goes, you know how I can get a hold of her? I said, no, Jack. And I wouldn't tell you if I did, you know. Down boy. I don't blame him for wanting to get a hold of her. She was something, man. That was one of the, that's what made it so difficult. And you could justify almost any kind of nonsense, couldn't you? Because she was a prostitute at one time, you know? You could justify any kind of crappy behavior in a situation like that. But you know what? I can't anymore. And I'd have to live with that, see? My consideration was not for her. It was for the guy next door. Can you imagine that? I'd actually grown a little, maybe, spiritually. I had somebody else's interests above my own at that moment. Wow, that was a different deal. So I knew I had grown a little bit. So when I think of this, when we read, we think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves. It quiets the imperious urge when to yield would mean heartache. To yield to that would have meant heartache for me. You understand? It's the way it is.
If we have been thorough about our personal inventory, we have written down a lot. We have listed and analyzed our resentments. We have begun to comprehend their futility and their fatality. We have commenced to see their terrible destructiveness. We have begun to learn tolerance, patience, and goodwill toward all men, even our enemies. For we look on them as sick people.
That's right. You know, you could say, that's a judgment, isn't it? We look on people as sick. Okay, that's a judgment. Yeah, he's a sick guy. But you know what? It's a better judgment than he's a jerk or some other term you might use. You see, it's a beginning step out of the problem instead of deeper into it. It's not the truth, but it's a beginning step away from the grievance. And I think this is what's important. See, that's why they ask us to look. Some of these things aren't the truth. They're just pointers, and they're leading you out of the darkness into the light. That's what it is. And but I've had people ask me about that sentence. You know, well, isn't that a judgment? Yeah, it is. It's a better judgment than he's a jerk.
And it's kind of an analysis. We read a couple of pages earlier that they, like ourselves, are sick too. So yeah. I'm looking on someone as a sick person. This is somebody who's in the same stuff I am. Yeah. This is somebody he's like me. We're fighting the same battles here.
It's not an indictment.
Right.
You can report. One of the things that I think alcoholics seem to be very confused about is we think we can't have an opinion or something about it without it being judgmental. You can report something and not be judgmental. You can just report something that happened and not have a value judgment on it. See, there's a difference. There's a big difference. Just the facts, ma'am. You know, like Joe Friday on Dragnet? Remember the old TV show, Dragnet? He used to go out. He was a detective. He'd go out to the house, and there'd be a crime or something, and he'd be going on and on about all emotional about what happened, and he'd say, just the facts, ma'am. That's kind of the way I take inventory. I do the Joe Friday inventory. Just the facts, ma'am.
We have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can.
Yeah, if we can. Sometimes you might not be able to. I don't know.
In this book, you read again and again that faith did for us what we could not do for ourselves.
That's right. That's what I saw. It's one of the first promises that came true for me was I intuitively knew how to handle situations that used to baffle me. That was the first thing that I became aware of in the promises. I just knew how to deal with certain things. It was amazing.
We hope you are convinced now that God can remove whatever self-will has blocked you off from him.
That's right. That's what's blocking me from God. Self-will. Rick's will. Selfishness. I want what I want. That's what's blocking me from an experience of love. I couldn't do a lot of the things I've done had I not been blocked. If I was not blocked, I would have acted differently in circumstances, and so would other people.
If you have already made a decision.
Third step decision.
And an inventory of your grosser handicaps.
That's what we've been looking at, our grosser handicaps throughout this process.
You have made a good beginning.
You've made a good beginning. It isn't the end. You've learned how to inventory yourself. It's just a start. Now I've got some tools that I can deal with things as they come.
That being so, you have swallowed and digested some big chunks of truth about yourself.
Oh boy, isn't that a fact, huh? Some of this isn't pleasant, I'll tell you that, to look at, but I'll tell you what, it's very rewarding. It has been extremely rewarding for me. And I'm very grateful for Alcoholics Anonymous and for this inventory. That's the only reason I try and teach this to other guys, is that I have a lot of gratitude for AA and what they wrote here. This is so well done, it's almost hard to imagine that somebody with 3 years sobriety, Bill, could have helped put this together with guys with less sobriety. You know? Think about what you were like at 3 years. How that they simply chronicle their experiences. That's all it is. And that's why it's true. That's why it works. They didn't write their collective theories. They just wrote, this is what we did that worked. If you want what we have, you'll do what we did. That's all. It's pretty basic stuff. You know.
From the beginning of Bill and Dr. Bob, they made lots of mistakes. They did all kinds of things wrong. They were trying different stuff. And when they found something that worked, that's what became this program, and that's what they wrote in this book.
Yeah, they didn't throw stuff in there for just fluff. Right. I've never seen anything in here that didn't have a purpose. It was done intentionally. Every sentence was intentional. So when they laid a warning in there, that's important. They did that because they saw trouble. They didn't just put we make amends where we have done harm provided. You know, they did that because they saw trouble in those areas. So I've had a lovely time here. You guys have been great, and I want to thank you guys for the opportunity to be here.